Good morning, everyone. This is Saharsh Damani, and welcome to FADA's yet another business series webinar on insurance business panel discussion. Now, technology is creating a buzz in the insurance sector with its interesting concepts of connecting people with products and services. The latest offerings of technology and digital systems are uniquely combining the physical groundwork of the insurance sector with its overall efficiency and transparency. Now, what is in it for the auto dealers in the insurance sector? Today, we have an eminent list of panelists who are joining us from Bajaj Allianz, ICICI Lombard, and Bharti AXA. I would now like to request our president, Mr. Venkesh Gulati, to kindly give his opening remarks and then take the proceedings further. Venkesh ji, over to you.
Thanks, Saharsh. Good morning, the distinguished panelists. Good morning, our dealer friends who are attending this webinar. So as Saharsh has said, this is yet again another webinar from our side for updating you on what is happening latest in different field. This time it is insurance. And we will be continuing such more webinars in future. So open to your suggestions if you have any concern in any other field where we can go ahead. So let me introduce our distinguished panelist. So Mr. Aditya Sharma, he is the head of motor business Bajaj Allianz General. He has 2 decades of experience in the insurance and financial industry. He has seen variety of roles in different channels, web sales, retail health, home insurance, virtual office and agency. His leadership has always been transformational as exploring digital initiatives, synergizing and evolving new distribution channels, and retail marketings have been core to his strategy. Mr. Sharma is a science graduate and holds a postgraduate management degree in finance and control from Himachal Pradesh University, Shimla. He is also a fellow of the Insurance Institute of India. Welcome, Mr. Sharma. It's a privilege to have you here. Next is Mr. Nitin Khanna. He is the head motor insurance business, emerging markets, key relations and marketing at ICICI Lombard General Insurance. Mr. Khanna has handled channels such as motor agency, banker insurance, giving him a holistic experience and insights across all key channels of the business franchise. Prior to joining ICICI Lombard in 2004, Mr. Khanna worked in the healthcare and pharma sectors in diverse roles in sales and marketing, having embarked on his corporate journey in 1998. Mr. Khanna is a BSc honors graduate from Delhi University with an MBA from MDI Gurgaon. He lives in Mumbai with his wife and daughter. Welcome, Mr. Khanna. So next, Mr. Raman Arora. He is the chief operating officer at Reliance General Insurance. He's a qualified chartered accountant and company secretary with experience in the fields of operation, motor claims, and customer service. He joined Reliance General Insurance on May 18, 2012. Mr. Arora has been associated with ICICI Lombard General Insurance Company and has over 18 years of experience. Welcome, Mr. Rama. Sharvik, our friend, he's the state chairperson FADA. For Rajasthan, he is Director Rajesh Motors Group, Jaipur. Rajesh Motors Group has over 6 decades of excellence in automobile industry and has diverse interest in automobile, earth moving equipments, mining and hospitality industry. The group represents Ashok Leyland, JCB, Volkswagen, Toyota, Kia, Royal Enfield across Rajasthan and Maharashtra. Sharvik is a strong professional with a BTech in mechanical engineering from Maharashtra Institute of Technology, Pune. He's a member of many organizations, FADA obviously, entrepreneur organization, the EO, the Indus Entrepreneurs, TIE, CII Rajasthan, Federation of Rajasthan Trade and Industry, where he serves or has served on many important posts. Welcome, Sharvik. Last but not the least, Vignesh, Mr. C.S. Vigneshwar, who is Secretary FADA and Director Annamalai's Toyota Coimbatore. He has been schooled in Don Bosco, Chennai, a commerce graduate from Loyola College, Chennai. MBA from GRD College, Coimbatore, and MSc in International Business from Manchester Metropolitan University. The Annamalai's group has interest in goods transportation, automobile dealerships, drinking water, packaged foods, renewable energy, green energy alternatives, farming, and education. Vignesh has been a member of APEC's consultative committee of Volvo Eicher Commercial Vehicles for the last 9 years and has been the president of Toyota India Service Dealer Council for the last 5 years. Welcome, Vignesh. Over to you, Serge, for the start of the insurance discussions panel.
Yeah, so before Mr. Vignesh takes over the hot seat, I will request all the participants to write their, mention their questions only in the Q&A box. We'll take all those questions once we are towards the end of our panel discussion. Over to you, Mr. Vignesh.
Thanks to, so much, Sarsh. Thanks for the introduction, Venkesh. I don't think I'll be on the hot seat because I'm surrounded by insurers. So at least I'm insured. So thanks so much. Saying that, we're getting into a very, very important vertical within our businesses. Our businesses could have a good time. I mean, could have a good run. It could also have a very rough run. And I think all of us would agree that in the last year and 3 months, we've been having a very choppy, uncertain run. But as we saw last year, the Indian automobile industry bounced back very, very strong with very, very good numbers, very good growth rates. The profitability also was there. I would expect something similar to happen this year. However, we have many, many verticals in our business, one being sales, one being service, and we can also have finance, accessories, and an important and integral and legally compliant part of our business would be the sale of insurance. And the sale of insurance is something which is very, very important, not only to our profitability, but also it is very important to the legal compliance which every dealer has towards his customers. Here, I look at the insurance vertical in a very different way. Yes, the insurance vertical also has excellent, as I call it, instant profitability because there are commissions associated with it. Not only that, insurance also paves a way where we are able to make sure that customers are insured. So tomorrow they're going to come back to us for body and paint work, which probably is a very important source of revenue for all dealerships. And more importantly, it is also another revenue where we're connecting with our customers year on year so that not only we are there to renew the customer's insurance, but we're also there to take care of the customer's suggestions regarding probably he could want another vehicle, or there are many, many ways where we can reconnecting with the customer helps. And this way, we're not troubling the customer because it's a legal complaint. We go back and say, sir, we need to renew our vehicle, or ma'am, could I offer you anything along with your better package along with the vehicle? And then we can actually carry off a lot more business. So it's a great opportunity to have three eminent gentlemen from three extremely, flag-bearing insurance companies. Thanks so much for you joining us, Aditya. Thanks, Raman, and also thank you so much, Nitin, for joining us today. As we are an automobile dealership organization, we always want to have questions towards profitability, towards what we need to do to become better at our dealerships. So one of the first questions which probably are topics which we would probably want to look at is the fact that how the motor insurance policy, it has evolved. We have seen how much things have changed over the last decade from what it was, let's say, 50 years ago. It has more competition. It is becoming more exciting. There are absolutely more innovations taking place here. But what do you gentlemen see going, looking into the future, how the future of the insurance products would change? Could I ask Raman to come into this question?
Yeah, very good morning to everyone. Thanks for inviting us. Let me start by saying this, this first and second wave has taught a lot of us to collaborate with partners, customers, vendors digitally. And that's the best thing which is happening now. What has brought this? This has brought a lot of millennials. Millennials generally are those guys which are born after 1980. But with the COVID first and second wave, I could see everyone has become millennials, right? Their thought process is so evolved and back with spending that they don't mind paying some extra money for convenience and customization. So let me start with an example now to answer this. See, my daughter is very fond of pizza. So whenever she select pizza, she select the base and spend a lot of time in selecting toppings, toppings which she likes or could be a new topping which is available. Trust me, why I gave this example, because there's an analogy to this future motor products. In future, motor will work like a pizza and selecting toppings, where customer will go drag and drop the cover he wants, right? And then pay and move out. It could be at any touch point. So give you the example. If there's a base, I would say TP policy is my base, which every customer should have. When I talk about cheese, it is like every customer should have an essential OD and a nil dap. But when it comes to topping, now you have a lot of toppings available. It could be consumable, it could be RTI, it could be RSA, it could be key cover. What would be relevant in future from 5 years now is exotic toppings. When I say exotic toppings, it could be something which is linked to your lifestyles. For example, though some of the covers are there in life, but it would be taken care by general also, maybe pet insurance under lifestyle. It could be hotel accommodations. It could also be loss of personal belongings. It could be daily allowance benefits. See, these are like toppings which a customer will select over a period of time. Because what I said is the customer has become so smart that he wanted to insure himself completely, especially after looking what has happened in COVID. Health is the most critical and the entire assistance is the most important piece which he needs at this moment of time. So one, I spoke about the lifestyle, which will come in future. It could also be demand of switch on and switch off, right? The simple example is RSA, where if somebody wants RSA, he switch on the service, the vendor comes to his place, or it could be a daily shore. For example, tomorrow I decide to take Mr. Nitin Khanna's car for a drive for a day, and something happens to the car and he wanted to save his NCP. So this cover will help him to save his NCP and I will buy a cover for a day. This is why I call it switch on and switch off. Or it could be like usage based product, which could be telematics based, where pay as you drive and pay how you drive is going to play a bigger role. See, what I perceive in the future is this entire IoT, Internet of Things, is going to play a bigger role. Where today, if you look at IAB or Vahan, gives you a lot of information. But in future, if you integrate Vahan, IAB, or you say financial score of a CBIL of a customer, traffic violation, or telematics of a manufacturer, and you combine all together, arrive at a score, then you can show a lot of products to the customer, which you just do drag and drop. So trust me, 5 years from now, or a decade maximum, it would be like selecting a pizza or a topping on the click of button. This is what I perceive, which will happen in future, looking at where do we stand today. Thank you.
I think that's a very, very interesting view you have brought in, how technology comes and influences buyers and the buying patterns. Nitin, I personally have worked with ICICI for a long time, and I know ICICI also is on the forefront of technology. So whatever Raman told me, it also reminds me is like pay as you go and select your toppings as a pizza. So you don't need to be compelled on a product or on a particular aspect which you don't want. You don't pick it up and you instead go and spend it on something else which you probably want. What do you think of this approach, pay as you go? Is it going to come back? Is there in the abroad in the United States and all that? Would it also happen in India?
So just to add to what Raman said, I think a couple of things like that. When de-tariffing happened, there was standard products, standard wordings. There were no add-ons available at that point in time. And we looked at the industry, what are the pain areas of the customer, and we tried to cover up those pain areas by adding a lot of new products. For example, Anil Tap was one such product. Engine Protect was one such product. Consumer one such product. I believe over a period of time, some of these basic add-ons will become a part of the base cover. If you look at today in a new car, I don't think NILTEP is an add-on cover. I don't know why we still call it an add-on cover. The attachment is as high as 99%. Everybody buys that cover. It is actually becoming a base cover because that was the need of the customer which got fulfilled by a insurance cover which was not available earlier. I think over a period of time, my sense is even engine product like covers will become a base cover. They will not be an add-on cover. And that is what Raman said, with the new different kind of add-on will kick in. So what have we done as an industry for last 8-9 years post de-tariffing? My sense is over a period of next maybe 1 year, or it already happened to a certain extent in at least in age group of 1 to 5 of cars, it has already happened. And beyond that, it will start to maybe manifest separately. So that will become a base cover. then we have to look at what are the other needs which a customer has been unattended by us as the insurance industry, and how do we cover up those needs. One clearly is rightly said, is the pay as you drive or pay how you drive with one product which will come up. But to give you some stats, even in developed countries like US, the penetration of pay as you drive or the telematics is less than 20%, in spite of they being running that kind of product for almost now 7 to 8 years. The organization like Progressive, State Farm, they're running those programs for quite some time, but the penetration is as in the range of 20s, but not even beyond that. So that is clearly one, but it will come in India. Definitely come in India. There are a lot of experiments which are happening. I can tell you on behalf of ICICI Lombard, we have done some work 2 years back and we continue the journey. And I'm sure the other panelists also would have been doing that journey in their company. That is, it is going to come. And the other area which is very critical, which will come at some point in time, is the mindset change of the consumer today and the change of the complete, I think the point with Raman is millennials. Now, I think I was only aware of millennials. Certainly when I was reading it a few days back, there's something called a Gen Z, which even ahead of millennials. And their mindset is very different from what I had or maybe all of us in this panel had in that age group. And it is changing. I remember a generation gap used to be bit after 10 to 15 years. Today, every 5 years, a generation gap. So the requirement of today's customer would be, if I'm not taking my car out, I don't need insurance. How do you move to a model which is a subscription model? I take my car out, I switch on my insurance, and I pay for that period when I am using my car. I come back home, I don't need my insurance for the next 5 days because I'm working from home, I'm on a vacation, switch it off. And some of these things will definitely come. If I were to put a time frame, my sense it will be sooner than later. Maybe in the next 24 months, we'll find some of those subscription models coming in insurance. It is already happening in the Western world. There are companies like Lemonade who are doing this renter insurance, subscription insurance. It will come. So that is one area I think which clearly will move. And the second would be the add-ons beyond what we are doing today. So some of the emergency covers, lifestyle covers, depending upon today, every customer is given a 15 lakh of personal accident cover. A guy buying a Mercedes and or a Alto is given the same cover today. So some of those things will also keep on changing and evolving in that sense, which will be covering your personal assets, covering yourself as an individual in that sense. And some of those covers will also come in. But if you talk about next 12 months, my sense is some of the basic covers of add-on will come part of a base cover. And pay as you go, pay you as you drive, and start picking up some steam. And some standard cover, I think, which are coming now in the industry would be on the better RSAs, better emergency covers. I think that will also come in maybe next few quarters. But beyond that, my sense it will be more of not only pay as you drive, but pay as you use your vehicle will also come in. So that is my perspective in terms of how the new products will evolve over a period of next maybe 24 months.
I think it's such a very interesting perspective because it also makes sure that something which is unutilized, as you said, for 5 days I'm going to not go out, I might as well not pay the insurance for it. And that really helps from the customer's perspective. Aditya, what I would really want to know is, there's a very interesting topic which was suggested to us to be spoken, is regarding the threat from online insurance companies. A lot of them are quite successful. Whenever we switch on a TV or open a magazine, there is this extremely good marketing by certain companies which actually talk about, weren't you buy online insurance directly from us? And a lot of these digital platforms are there and they are vying for our space. It's also, as I told you, insurance being such an important vertical for us, profitability is something which is very closely associated with the business, with the insurance vertical. Keeping that in mind, how we as dealers, how do you think we can compete with such online companies and digital platforms? Over to you. Yeah.
So thank you, Vinesh. I think today we have woke up, I was mentioning with someone else also, to a new platform, which was a food delivery platform, that is Zomato. And you have seen the kind of, you know, interest everybody is taking there. And the valuation is going through the roof. The people are saying that this is the next thing. Actually, if you see, we have such people and platforms which are developing from the past, say, a decade or so.
If you look at Amazon, it's close to, you know, 2 decades now. So it took its time, it has evolved, and that is how it is working. But the only thing is, do we want to stop it, or do we want to say that how can we compete with them? That is not probably the question. The question is, everybody is going and looking forward to new technology. They want to make their lives easier by using it, and they want to use more and more technology going forward. So if that is the case, so we cannot say we how to compete is not the question. Can we collaborate? Can we start looking at it? How can we work more? And what are the capabilities that we are developing to be competitive there also? So even in, if you look at food delivery, the manufacturer is still the restaurant only. They are only delivering, and they have their margin, and they are taking some pain of the customer out. And at the same time, they are taking pain out of the restaurant also out, because they don't have, they have that much of sitting space. Though the customers who don't care for probably the ambience and experience of the restaurant, they are okay to have their food at home. So similarly, are there services? It's not only in insurance, it's in even surveys, even in the other part of the you know, value chain of the entire automobile sector, where what are the services which we can provide customer at his doorstep? What are the things which we can do for them? And the most important part, at least in insurance, from my point of view, is that the role of everybody, including the dealer, the insurer, manufacturer, and the platform, will remain. It will evolve. It will come to a stage where everybody will go to a platform. If you are not converting yourself as an OEM or a dealer association or an insurance company to a platform, it will become very difficult to sustain. But what will be the role of the dealer? The role of the dealer, especially in the new cars and the renewals, will be of an influencer. So you see, what people are doing, they are trying to buy many things online. But ultimately, they say, okay, can someone guide me that what is important for me? They come. So you cannot probably directly, the intention of a regulator, intention of others, is that the customer should have a choice. But too much choice also, you know, spoil the entire setup. So who is there, who will guide him, what is right? Which is the company, which are the organization, which are giving better services, which will sustain, which will have better turnaround time. Ultimately, it's going to be good for the customer, but that intelligence, that knowledge, and that experience, the dealer principal will have to bring in. They will have to influence their decision, which will be a win-win situation, not only for the dealership, for the manufacturers of insurance policies, which are good, they are providing good services, but for the customer also, because most of this pain ultimately will go away when the dealer is assuring them that if you go for this kind of cover, or these are the, Raman just mentioned that we need to, he will have to choose his toppings and all. So who is the better person that you run this much of, say 100 kilometers a day, or you are running only 20 kilometers a day? What is the difference? So you always look forward to somebody who's more intelligent or more aware than me in that field. So I think the role will definitely be there. That platform will evolve. It is definitely going to come. But can we collaborate with them? Can we provide better services to the customers? I think that is one thing which will decide the future of both the platforms also, and us who are in the distribution of insurance services in some way or another.
Very interesting. So I can take 3 C's from you. You are saying collaborate, you're saying consult, and you're saying compete. So in this order. So if, as long as we can do it, I guess we'll also be a strong player and a strong choice for the customer being at the moment. Thank you so much. Can I also hear from Sharvik, who's one of the strongest dealer partners, and he's also a very, very strong leader in his state chairmanship. He's joining us today. Thank you so much. And can you talk about, from the dealer's perspective, regarding what online aggregators are to a dealer?
So I think Mr. Aditya covered it quite well. Because of this online platforms, when we as dealers, try to pitch our insurance covers, or even during renewals, these people are all aware of what's happening. They've already done their research when they walk into our showrooms. They know what to expect, and they know what to, you know, what they are asking for and what they're paying for. So yes, I think what Mr. Sharma said is exactly what we need to train our team also. And that's the biggest challenge today we are facing is, you know, how do we consult and, you know, compete with these is the thing. But, you know, where I see the gap coming is most of these online portals are not able to clearly mention, and there is not a proper apple to apple comparison between what is being offered online and what we are able to give at our end. So I think that's something very patiently the customer has to be taught from our dealer end to understand, and that's where we can be competitive. And of course, the best part at the dealership is the services eventually, you know, in terms of, in case of the risk being addressed, how we are able to serve them and, you know, get our services. And that's the highlight that as a dealer, we need to push in.
It's so interesting that a lot of your thoughts actually mirror each other. That's Aditya and Sharvik, because Sharvik, you also talked about how collaboration in terms of the customers are better informed by the time they come to us. So I think online aggregators, I would assume they also play a big role in customer education. And
indeed, they do.
So that's great. And if we can stick with the same education and information and, you know, being up to date topic, we'd also like to know on how EVs, which are going to be, I mean, which is the next frontier in automobiles, how they are going to affect the business of insurance. When we talk about it, they say there are hardly any moving parts, but accidents do happen. But in case that happens, how are the workshops going to survive? Because there are going to be lesser parts which get damaged, which is good for the customer, but probably we want to hear from you, your thoughts about it. So can I actually have Aditya to again give us a little bit of a hint on what things are?
So I think there are two, three things. One is electric vehicle. We are saying, again, it's the same thing. Can we avoid electric vehicle? Probably not, because the way the space is evolving, especially in two-wheeler and three-wheelers, goods carrying and the local transport, especially there, and all the delivery and Olas and Ubers and all these share mobility things, they are eventually, those are the things which are moving to EV space. So if from insurance point of view, first I'll take that, because from insurance point of view, we say that EV, electric vehicle, is nothing but this is computer on the wheels. It's not a traditional vehicle. It's a computer on the wheel. So it will have, you know, specifications and problems like a computer. So I agree with you that the repair could be smaller and the customer or the accidents could be lower. But in a country like India, we still don't foresee that there will be auto drivers kind of cars. Still, the people will only drive. Their driving behavior is not going to change. On top of it, whatever vehicles I have seen or test driven, maybe from a few of the new manufacturers or a few abroad also, the power is so huge that even they get into, you know, 0 to 60 or 0 to 100 in maybe less seconds than we used to see all the other ICE engines. So till the time the driving behavior will change, the repair and all those things will say, but it will get more complicated. So earlier we may not have computer engineers in our workshops. Now we will have to have. For insurers like us, we were not having people who used to understand the coding and the other software related issues in our surveyors and in our service engineers. We will have to hire, and if we cannot hire, then we have to retrain our staff to look into those things, that how to look at it. And the covers will also evolve. For example, if now I'm running a computer, in computer I need probably a cover which will protect me against hacking. Somebody driving in, you know, if we are perceiving problems, somebody is driving in the different lane where he's controlling my car by hacking my software, he can do. So you will have to probably foresee that what are the kind of problems which can come on a computer on the wheel, which is EV, especially when it will come to private car or the large
goods carriers, then can we have those kind of products? Maybe something about cybersecurity, maybe something about I just mentioned hacking. So obviously we have not thought through, because we are getting those much covers, and as of now everybody is concerned about is a battery. So everybody is saying if the battery is resolved, then EV is also resolved. So as of now, how to charge it, where to charge it, and what is the life of that battery? These are the things which are concerning most of the people. Once that is clear, then probably rest of the things we will figure out. And I think the only question of survival is how we evolve ourselves. If all of us, for example, manufacturer, insurance companies, and the dealership, their workshop, they are equipped and they are ready that this is a reality. And we will have to get into those mode where we are saying it's not only nuts and bolts, but now it's coding, now it's chips, now it's... So these kinds of... So everybody will have enough work, because ultimately the things which are running, they will get into some kind of, accidental or damage or something also. And those are more severe and probably more costly also. So the thing is, we will be in business as long as we are adapting to the new changes, we are embracing the changes, we are open to learn from our mistakes and learn from the new experiences, and we are collaborating with those kind of people who are actually into this kind of business. I think we are pretty excited about this space, and this will only change the entire paradigm of the motor insurance and motor business for the good, and it's good for environment. That is what everybody is ultimately saying, that we all of us are sane people and we look forward to an environment which is, or the technology which is more environment friendly, so that we can hand over our next generations a better world in which we used to operate. So that is it.
Inisha, can I add something?
Please, Ram.
Yeah. Just Aditya, your voice is fumbling. I think there's some connectivity issue. Just to keep you posted. Vinisha, I think from a customer point of view, if you look at the number sales of EV, it is primarily in two-wheelers, right? Because the shopkeeper will keep a two-wheeler just to deliver goods, because the range is lower. It could be half a kilometer or 1 kilometer. As a customer, when he buys a car, he says, one, my landing cost versus my IC engine cost, or kitne kilometer chalegi from one charge. That's the primary thing which he thinks of. And the charging station is going to play a bigger role in if you are going to sell EVs. Wherever you see petrol pumps, now you need the charging stations. It could be even at the petrol pump itself, because what you need is a time. Aapne gayi gaadi leke charge ke and you went away, right? This is something which a customer will look at. Because if I have to travel from here to Surat, I need a charging station in between, which should be available on my company portal, mobile app, or it could be on Google, which is easily. Petrol mein we don't have such tension, or a diesel, right? Second, what Aditya said rightly, each of the insurance company has to upgrade their knowledge level now. Along with RSA has a bigger role to play. If I'm traveling to Surat and my car stucks up, right, because of battery drained out, then the RSA should be there along with the charger, so that he can charge my vehicle there and then I can take it to the nearest place. So both the RSAs, dealers, and the insurance company has to build this ecosystem so the customer feels it is as good as driving an IC car. So I thought I'd just add to what Aditya said. So
thank you. Thank you so much, Raman. I think what you folks are telling is the whole ecosystem has to walk hand in hand, and the ecosystem has to develop equitably. Therefore, the customer is going to be having a seamless experience. Another question which I probably carry in mind is, if I can ask Nitin this, is regarding how to avoid disputes for non-cashless cases during final settlement and also to get interim payments. This is always a big issue for non-cashless customers. How are we going to handle this, and how are we to go ahead? Because sometimes there's a huge lack of capital within this kind of a categorization.
For an interim payment for a cashless, I think most of us do as an industry, depending upon the size of the claim. For a small value claims, obviously, it's a reconciliation program both for the dealership and the insurer in that sense. But for a value above certain claims, I think interim payment is an industry norm and a lot of us do it. I don't see that a big challenge. And depending upon if there is 50% to be paid at the time of the survey, I think that is a manageable thing for most of the insurers. And we do at times a lot of our dealer partners. On the On the non-cashless thing, if you look at private card today, at least in our portfolio, and maybe Aditya and Raman can validate that, upwards of 90% today is a cashless claim. I think there's a very minuscule number on the private card side, which is left on the non-cashless side, both because of the distribution space or the service space, which all of you as a fraternity have created beyond your sales point. I think each one of you have far more service point than the sales point, and which is clearly led to that kind of coverage. And the OEM tie-ups which are happening, which is leading to cashless arrangements of insurance company with every partner of their dealer partner of there. So the non-cashless as an entity, as a mode of settling claim is significantly coming down. And my sense is the way the distribution is happening, the customer is aware of cashless and will move in that direction only. So that in the long run, I don't see that as a challenge. And even I think just to take that point of EV forward and combining the two, if you look at the point that today some of these IC engines or the smaller cars can be repaired in maybe smaller garages also. But as you move ahead on the technology, I think the role of a dealer on repairing or the servicing of a vehicle may become far more bigger than what it is today. If you look at a premium car today, right, they don't go to a roadside garage to get repaired. Maybe a smaller vehicle does go. Reason? Because the technology of that car is so different that a small side roadside garage can't manage the repair and servicing. So as we move into that direction, EV, more technology, and that will only go up. I think today, I'm sure each one of you know the kind of indicator that you get from the engine, how do you repair that. It is far more technology driven than it used to be maybe just 3 years before. So as we keep on moving in that direction, the vehicles become more and more technology driven, more and more complicated. The role of dealer will keep on increasing in servicing them, in repairing them. And that will also drive the industry towards more of a cashless than a non-cashless thing. The non-cashless today continues to be a prominent phenomena more in two-wheelers and commercial vehicles. Now that also is because of the lack of service infrastructure by the dealer fraternity. I don't think a lot of CV dealers today invest as much on the workshop as a private car dealer would do. I'm sure if you have 3 sales points, you would have maybe 30 service points. Any dealers. And the similar kind of trend might not be there for a two-wheeler or a commercial vehicle. And that's why the industry on the cashless, non-cashless keeps on being there. So for me, the answer to that would be increasing the service infrastructure by dealers. And dealers, a lot of us insurance companies are part of that tie-ups where we provide those cashless services. So that might take on terms of cashless versus non-cashless. And on the interim payment, definitely, I think each of the dealers friend will have to kind of work with their respective partners. I don't see that too much of a challenge because a lot of payments have been automated. A lot of claim processing has been automated. So the moment we receive the survey, we know what is the estimated claim and all of that can be managed because the construction is far more easier today than it used to be earlier.
Thank you so much. Harmik, I would probably want to hear from you regarding your viewpoints on this particular topic. You could also club with this another topic which talks about total loss vehicles.
Yeah.
And total loss vehicles sometimes spend weeks or months in our parking lot, and our parking lots sometimes are quite expensive in terms of space availability. So how does these things affect you as a dealer?
Of course, before I answer that, Vignesh, I would like to draw Mr. Khanna's attention on the CV business also, because I think that's another place where a lot of the disputes that you said about, talked about come up. Undoubtedly, Mr. Khanna, what is happening is, I would debate on that in terms of the network of CV workshops that are there. I'm saying today, even CV principals and CV dealers are realizing that margins and the service is important and service network has to grow. At the same time, you know, the amount of discounts and the is going up so much in CV, and I'm sure a lot of places, most of the private insurance companies have withdrawn from doing certain CV business, predominantly because the loss ratios are going up. I'm saying this is something that needs to be addressed immediately. Until and unless, as a whole, the industry doesn't agree to control discounts to the level it has gone. I mean, you've gone up to 90-95% discounts on CV premiums. So that is one place I think is a bit of concern. And as CV dealers, a lot of us are losing this opportunity in this business. And as again, answering to your point, Vignesh, it's actually a fact. I'm saying not only in cars, commercial, even in commercial vehicles, huge, you know, scrap is getting collected. There is a lot of time taken by the insurance companies to clear that out and take an action on that. So I think that's been, especially, you know, in capital cities or in metros, real estate is big. And we are anyways, you know, fighting for base space so that we can take more business in. So I think that is one place where you guys need to work on a faster track to get this out of, you know, the system, or probably work on a way that immediately that's while the survey is coming and doing its survey and closing the, giving a final okay. Same time, the scrap value is ascertained. We get in a scrap dealer, get that liquidated immediately so that everything is settled then and there. So I think that's a big concern. And also, you know, ascertaining a total loss vehicle. Many times when you're close to that value, you know, you tend to move towards a total loss. If that can also be addressed, I'm saying where there is viable repairs possible, I think that again is something that there's a very thin line to cross or not to cross. It's something that we expect insurance companies to take a sincere call on.
Yes, I think, Sharanjan, just to add one clearly, I think when I said CV versus private, I was using more relative example that the private car is far more rich than CV. I'm sure what you at least said, CVD is also realizing the importance of service and repair and expanding on that. Very fair point. I think just to add to the second part of picking up the salvage and total loss vehicles, I think it's equally a concern for insurance industry also, because the delay in picking up the vehicle also reduces the value for us as an insurer. If we're able to sell it in the first go, we'll get far, realize far more value than the if we delay in that sense. So I think it's a benefit for both of us to do that. We'll definitely, as a company, look into that. I'm sure my fellow colleagues will also kind of work internally and see how we can kind of help the dealer fraternity on that side. But obviously, it is equally beneficial for both dealer fraternity and for insurance companies to pick up some of the salvage on priority. So I don't see that as a challenge or a dispute among dealer fraternity and us as an insurance company. That is clearly in that direction. And just to answer the question on discounts, I mean, I joined the state 10 years back, there were maybe 4 PSUs and 8 or 10 private sector companies were dominant in that, right? Today, we have more than 30 companies competing in this space. So there are certain things which can never be controlled, right? Discounts is not which as an industry we can control, because each one of us at some point in time in their life journey will have different objectives. And they will continue to do that. I think what we need to build, whether for a dealer friends of ours or us as insurance companies, how do we differentiate our product and services vis-a-vis somebody who's only playing on price? And that is what we need to build upon, both for customers and for insurers for that matter. But just to give an example, if you're able to build a long-term engagement with the customer for those 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, till the time he owns that vehicle and comes to you, I'm sure he'll be willing to give you some extra leverage on the pricing and work with you. But beyond certain level, we can come together and tell you that we'll control pricing, but it's a competitive world. At the end of the day, if you look at OEM front, there are price cuts which happen, there are competition which happen. So that will be very difficult to control. I think rightly said earlier by Aditya also, we should look at what we can control ourselves, what are the areas we can work upon together. So I'd be very happy to engage with any of my dealer friends in terms of how to build a long-term customer engagement programs for dealers, for their customers, so that we're able to retain them in the dealership. And that will also take care of the other concern which was raised earlier on the aggregator. See, aggregator today is doing a one-time transaction with the customer. Right? He's not engaging that customer for those 12 months. Whereas all of you have the opportunity to engage with that customer for 12 more than that. So how do you work during that time frame instead of looking at renewal as a time where you engage with the customer? How do you look at those 12 months between that and subsequently in terms of engagement with the customer, working with them, offering them different VAS services? And that will only help us to compete with some of the new players which are coming, because they will come. We can't stop them, right? Echoes of this word will come. They will do what they have to do. We will have to focus upon what we can do together as a as a group in terms of driving some of our own objectives and play on our strengths instead of looking on what they are playing upon.
So I think all these operational challenges would be popping up, and these are sometimes which I've been continually hearing for the last two decades. So probably we really need to go to the lowdown, see where the challenges are and address them together. And then probably we could be quite successful at it. Aditya, what I would really like to bring you in is, it's a well-known fact that nearly 66% of all two-wheelers flying in the on the roads are uninsured. So not only it's a huge opportunity, but it is also a massive responsibility on our industry and as partners of the industry to make sure these are insured. What are your thoughts on it? How, as dealers, we can play a role in making use of this business opportunity? It's not only for two-wheelers, but also for commercial vehicles and for four-wheelers. This is there. How do you do it?
Yeah, so if you look at it, you have rightly mentioned that in two-wheelers, it's more severe because when the kind of customer profile, you can say, or you know that how many, why in India people take insurance, because this is a statutory requirement to some extent. But it has evolved in private cars because people have seen the benefits. Because if earlier people used to take, say, when I joined Bajaj Allianz in 2001, then people used to say, okay, it will take 3 months minimum to get a claim. So who will take a claim? They were not buying cars probably, because buying a car is easy, but maintaining it, that is what my father used to tell me. Maintaining a car will be a difficult tomorrow if there is an accident for 1 lakh rupees. How will I pay? Because I'll not take second loan to pay. But now with insurance evolving and all of us coming together, we have, you know, come so far. So the second question now, in two-wheeler, still people feel, okay, it's okay, and I am having third-party insurance. Same is the case with CBE, but in commercial vehicle, at least if you are going for fitness and all other things, you need to have those vehicles. So so we need to evolve with the time. So what time is saying now? Everybody is saying data is the new oil now. So how effectively we are using our data? We have sold vehicles in last 5 years, 10 years or 7 years. And do we know from our data, do we have that insight that the average, you know, ownership of that vehicle is for how many years? So what we can offer as an insurance and forward-looking insurance company or an insurer and a partner to the program and partner to all our dealer friends is that we can collaborate with them. That, okay, these are the vehicle you have sold in last 5 years. This is the data. And these are the digital journeys probably, because it's impossible to reach out to so many people, then calling them, then probably, you know, trying to knock their doors and saying and convincing them. Can we have some kind of digital journey, maybe where we can send a link to them that this is, it will cost only a cup of tea for you, a daily cup of tea that you get your two-wheeler insured. Same is a case with probably a commercial vehicle, that you should have at least these kind of insurances with this, and these are the benefits. So the ultimate thing is how we are making the customer aware. One, this is ignorance. The second, the availability of the product. So if I am not getting it on my mobile phone, or I have to call somebody from my agent or somebody else, and then I have to go and take my vehicle there. I have to click the photograph because I generally want to get my two-wheeler, four-wheeler or commercial vehicle got insured. But the hassle says that who will take this hassle? I'm okay for next 4 or 5 days. So if we make all those things, if we make those things easy, and the journey is also easy for our customer by making or enabling the self photographs by the customer in the same link, or video streaming in the same link, then the payment options are also easy. The dealer partner is sending links, and both of us are collaborating. And we know that there is no trust deficit also, where the customer of one will go to other. Everybody will, get into the same, we will get the business, and the credits and the other things can be, sorted out later on. So all those things which are there, it can help. We are willing to collaborate as an insurance company, as a partner. And we are, in fact, we have approached few of our dealer partners for such kind of activities. And the results that we are seeing is very good. So the only thing is a long path. Awareness is one thing. The second is availability.
if we provide, if we match both somewhere, I think we have a lot of market unexplored and we can expand the market also. More companies are coming, 30, 40 come, and few more will come as the regulation has said that shareholding pattern has changed. The foreign partners can put in more money. More companies will come. There are companies, countries like Singapore, they have hundreds of companies. UK, they have, I think, in all the markets. So we can't stop them. We can't control the rates. We can't control the market. But the only thing is, how can we collaborate and acquire more and more customer? Ultimately, that will have more value than anything else.
Vignesh, can I add something now on this? You're on mute, Vignesh. Can I add something to what Aditya said?
Please go ahead.
If you look at the entire ecosystem, Vahan has all the information with respect to vehicle registration, PUC, start date, end date. If you're looking at the ecosystem at the country level, the only thing what is needed is to tell customer that your vehicle is running without insurance, which has to be triggered, say as a broader picture. When it comes to an insurance company, what you need, as what Aditya and Nitin said, you need a digital experience, one touch renewal, and you are done. That is what a customer look at. But both these things works on one principle, that is contactability. If you have a number, right, to reach to the customer, definitely if you remind him that you're without insurance and that awareness is built, they will go and renew. That contactability at the industry level is a concern, which generally figures around 40-50%, and two-wheeler is slightly low. But look at the two-wheeler customer who will also have a health policy or a private car policy with any one company. What we needed is contactability to start with to push renewal, both at the dealers, customer, insurance company. Because if most of the vehicles who are running on the road are insured, look at the financial impact it will make on the economy, because any uninsured vehicle is an impact. Right. So my point was, Vahan is one which could be a touch point, a simple digital journey of one click. And third is contactability and awareness program along with the dealership and the insurer to push for more insurance.
You talked about, you hinted a little bit about database accuracy. I know it's terrible in terms of accuracies, but there are multiple challenges towards it, and probably all of us need to work towards and solve it. If I can also touch upon technology there, can AI be used to actually bring, I know there are privacy issues here, but as you said, this particular customer would be having health insurance or life insurance or some form of insurance apart from the automotive insurance. Is it some way that can be used, AI can be used here? And is there some way AI also can be used on surveys? Because yes, we have gone a long way from physical to online surveys. But even online surveys, when it comes to approvals, we touched upon it. But can AI be used to make sure it's an even faster and seamless experience, not only for surveys, but also for contacting customers and making sure that they are having insured vehicles?
I don't think it's not even a long distance away, Vignesh, in my mind. I think it is up there. It'll come very soon. I think a lot of us have been working on that. So the first step on that was digital survey, I think, which has now been established. And maybe the positive impact of the COVID has been that both the customer, the dealer fraternity, the insurance companies have equipped themselves in terms of managing that digitally. In that. So that was the first biggest hurdle which is crossed in my mind. And the second is using AI and ML to do self-assessment in that sense. Now, it's an ongoing technique. You should keep on, as the name suggests, you should keep on make the machine learn more and more and reach some level of efficiency and accuracy. And that is the only objective with which you work on the AI and ML side. And how do you make machine as accurate as a human being? I think we have been doing those pilots for last almost 12 to 18 months. In some set of claims, I think we have reached accuracy of almost 85-90%. And very soon we'll start launching it. And my sense is, a lot of my colleagues also will kind of echo that point, that technology-driven insurance companies will be moving in that direction sooner than later. I don't see even it a 24-month project. My sense, it is maybe a two-quarter project where you will see a lot of some part of claims moving towards AI and ML. A large, maybe less than 25,000 claims will start moving in that direction very soon. I don't see that in a very long-term horizon now. The way we are equipped today, it's a matter of maybe a quarter or two where you will see a lot of adoption of AI and ML on the service side from most of the tech-enabled insurers, and it will not be limited to few of us. most of the technical insurers will start moving in that direction in a quarter or two. Maybe Aditya and Ramani want to add to that.
Yeah, I think if I may.
Please.
So I think, as Nitin has rightly said, that most of us have already started the journey. We, you know, started kind of, we can say the app, so we call it OTS on the spot. We have done a limited pilot last year, and it was quite successful. Say 20 minutes or 30 minutes time, you can actually transfer the money. So ultimate aim, so we call it AI, we call it ML. But ultimate aim is how can we provide the same kind of service to our customer where we are like a swipe of a credit card. And the expectation of the customer is, if I'm going somewhere, I'm swiping my card, my payment is done, my everything is settled. They are doing it in some way. You should also be in a position to do it in some other way. You figure out how to do it. So ultimately, if everybody, each one of us have started thinking and conceiving it, I know that it's not that simple because there are few things. And the thing is, it can enable, say, it will have, say, 90% efficiency, 95% of efficiency. But the tomorrow, again, where is our role as insurance company and those who are collaborating more with our dealer partners and the dealerships and OEM and probably with all of our friends in the market, where there will be a dispute maybe for one case or five cases. There, the confidence will again come back. There is some shoulder to cry. There is something where which at least listens to me. The problem with technology, how customer foresee it is that if it is going through the technology, then there is nobody who will, you know, listen to me. If as long as we are, you know, maintaining that human and technology combination in a better way, and we are solving the problems of our customers, I think it's all right, and it's not far off. I think we are already on the journey. In a year or so, I think we will start having a matrices where we are tracking that, okay, now claims less than 25,000, we are able to settle in 30 minutes or so, or the payment is getting transferred. So that is the probably way forward for the present situation.
That will certainly be helpful to us. However, right now, moving on to Sharvik. Sharvik, there's always been this question about having a comprehensive policy and a kind of an umbrella policy for all automobile dealers, so that they are able to take care of the third-party liability and vehicles.
Absolutely. Vignesh, one of the most important things that the dealer fraternity has been asking for. Once a new vehicle reaches the doorsteps, we have various insurance covers that we need to take. If you want to insure our vehicle during a new vehicle when it has come into a stock, so there's a different stock insurance. But if it has to go and get a PDI done or is it getting into our showrooms, there is a different insurance that we need to do. There is a different insurance we have to cover for, you know, vehicles standing in a workshop, which have come goods in trust, as in they've come for repairs at us. We actually are looking at getting an umbrella policy where it is covered for all those vehicles which have come for work with us, which are in stock with us. Most of these things are under one premises at most dealerships. So, Vignesh, you've rightly covered this. I think we are indeed in a desperate need of a good umbrella policy. So I'd like to ask the panelists if, you know, what they have to say about this.
Yep. So may I?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, so this coverage under umbrella policy for assets of an auto dealer is not there in Indian motor tariff, but this risk can be covered under commercial line business, though it's a package policy. Which where an automobile dealer is exposed to maybe falling types of risks, could be fire, machinery breakdowns, burglary. These coverages are available, which can be customized, but not under motor, but it could be covered under commercial line.
We're just looking for something seamless here, Ram.
Yeah.
We seem to be running from pillar to post, understand one particular liability if it arises. We have to, sometimes I don't have a clue whom to go and give it to or which insurance it comes under. So if it's seamless, if you can work with someone, the regulators or whoever is required to be worked with, I think it will really help us out in terms of peace of mind.
Good opportunity for you guys also.
Yes.
Fair point, Shavishtan and Vignesh. I think two things there, just to add to what Raman said. So this product is available. I think as most of the time we understand insurance is a matter of subject to socialization. So there are complications always involved in that sense. So how do we simplify the product for our dealer fraternity? And also, I think the other area I would like to add to what you guys said, and which may be a more progressive dealership should look at, identify their insurance needs. Today, I don't think everybody looks at a simple fire or a stock area or maybe burglary area, not look at the complete comprehensive insurance which they should need. Only when the eventuality happens, they look at. There's a fair feedback, and though that product exists, but I don't think it has been as simplified, and even the journey of buying is also not as simplified. Maybe we'll have to look at that together, industry, and come back to our friends on how do we can work on that product. But the product is definitely available. It is a matter of working together, and maybe with some of the dealer partners, we can sit together and maybe make that product and ensure that it goes to every partner of mine. But that product is definitely available. That I don't see a challenge on that side. But making it simpler, making it more able to reach to every dealer in terms of their needs and assessment of that is what we need to work as an industry. A fair feedback will take that.
And if you are able to get this done, the kind of relief, because this is not a core competency. Our core competency is to go and sell and look after the customer.
Again, Manisha, so we all have covers. You just need to customize it as per the needs. So it should not be a problem.
And just to tag along the same topic, there's also the question about why the high cost for trade plate insurance, and also the high deductibles in trade plate claims. So this is something which probably, anyone of Aditya, if you could probably talk about it, it'll be great.
So I think, again, it all boils down to the same thing. The price kind of, so you have this much, say 100 rupees. So normally the expectation is I am having this much of business, you should compensate it. So as an insurance product manufacturer, what my thinking is when we are talking about insurance technicals and products, innovation and everything, that my thing is that product has to be a self-sustained product on its own. Right. We can look at products which are good. We can look at all the kind of fancy coverages, including a few of the liability covers can also be covered probably in the tread plate policy also. So what we are looking at is that all kind of covers are available. We can, there are many things which are de-tariffed now. We can always look at it and file with the help of all the feedback that we are receiving from it. And we are willing to, and we will see, give a serious attempt to all this. The only thing is, at some point in time, it does not happen in all the cases, but in few cases where the dispute normally comes in, that this much premium was paid and this much claim has been taken. The last 10 years, I have not taken claims. So insurance is kind of risk, risk mitigation kind of, or it should come in a risk management thing. So and because we are into this business and we understand it more, and we do a day and day night with our customer, we advise them. So if we are advising them, I think price is not an issue today also, because the only thing is, if it is making sense, any one of us, and I can say on behalf of all, is willing, more than willing to do it, and we do also in most of the cases. But if we say that there has to be a cover in rupees one, but I am the insurance company is making some money or not, in the long run that product will not be able to sustain. That is what
I think the builder, I think as an insurance company, we are supposed to write risk, right? And every risk will have its own price. Now, the other way to look at that problem could be, Vinayasan, how do we mitigate that risk? If you're able to mitigate that risk together, identify certain areas on which you can work so that the risk come down or the loss come down, obviously the price will come down. I think, as you rightly said, we as insurance companies are more than happy to give discounts. I don't think we are not willing to give discounts. You look at how the market is operating. I think what Sharvik-san said, as an industry, we are reaching 95% discount if it makes risk sense there, right? The industry does that. It is not only, why only look at trade, look at fire, look at school buses, right? The example you had taken earlier. So there people, we go as an industry of 90% discount because the risk mitigation is there. Every school bus today comes with that speed controller kind of stuff. So we know that the risk mitigation which is put in, and I can price for that risk. But if that is not there, the risk price will be what the loss will entail in the future in that sense. So some of them both will have to go in tandem for us to work together in the industry in terms of both risk and the price side.
I think we can certainly work with our insurance partners to start reducing all these costs by making sure we are able to have some mitigating measures.
Yes.
So I think that's bringing a lot of clarity towards us. If you can probably engage with you later on to see what are these mitigation measures we can actually work together as FADA, and as the, if you can advise us, we could probably go back to our dealers and advise them on how to bring down those costs.
Fair point.
Really interesting, and thanks so much. Another topic which has come up is regarding the break-in policy renewal issues, where when there's a gap, let's say there's a gap month or a gap year or wherever. So what are the challenges at this point, Sharvik, if I can have your viewpoint on where are these issues, what are the issues which we are facing, and how? What are the challenges we would like the insurance partners to address?
Yeah, so, I think this pandemic also, made us realize during the lockdowns and things, people were not able to renew the insurance in time. And there were a lot of break-in insurance that came in. I think considering the relationship that the customers had with us, I think there should be, what are the legalities to that? If that probably can be digitized as we are doing for surveys, or try to, fasten that process. Mr. Sharma, you said it's like swiping a card. If we can work on getting that done faster and the process can be shortened, that will always help us. I'm saying again, Mr. Khanna, this is also taking us back to, that the thought that people are saying, getting into a subscription model or pay as I go. I mean, these thoughts have to be evolved and solutions have to be created now.
Rightly said, sir. I think just to give you a sense on break-in inspection. So for us as an insurance company, HSA Lombard, we don't do physical surveys now. Our break-in is completely AI/ML driven. Our 90-minute survey, if you do as a consumer, you do the video, we'll give you a real-time yes or no. We don't even get a physical survey or somebody sitting behind the computer and saying yes or no. So break-in survey for us is fully AI/ML driven. Okay. You take the video as a consumer or as a dealer, you can take a video. Okay. We'll tell you yes and no through the machine itself. We'll not even wait for somebody to look at that video. And I don't know if Raman want to add to something.
Yeah, I think what is required in break-in, except the COVID period, which Mr. Shah said, right? There was genuinely a miss by a customer because they were locked down. And in that scenario, I think some of the insurance people would have said, okay, break-in will allow something because the vehicle would have moved out, right? Which is practically... But if there's not a COVID time and there's a break-in, the only thing which insurance company wants to see whether there's a damages or not, existing damages, which generally help a customer, because if there's a damages and it doesn't disclose, it may impact the claim at the later stage. So what is needed is a break-in inspection. And what Nitin said is what is evolving in future is, aapne break-in inspection kiya, click photos at the time, say, you say yes, no, you're done. What is needed is the convenience of doing a break-in inspection by the customer itself. If you go a decade back, it used to happen through a PA agency where you have to keep coordinating with everyone. Our pioneer way is a customer. That was a painful exercise. What is needed is on the spot break-in inspection, say yes or no. This is why the industry evolving around like this.
So we are talking about more and more technology becoming an enabler here, and technology becoming a partner wherein it reduces all the reduces space, reduces distances, reduces time. So I think as an industry, we really need to embrace technology as such. Another question also comes on a very similar topic is regarding insurance companies porting options while renewals with continued benefits of accumulated NCB. So how do we go about this one, Nitin?
So we have those products available. There's a product called NCB Protection, and which is available right now also, which covers the customer in terms of one claim. It still hold on to the NCB. So that product is available. It has not been so well accepted because of the pricing of that product is slightly more on the higher side because the risk associated is very high. You see, one of the biggest challenges which we face in the industry and what Nilda changed is the tendency of customer to claim or not to claim. In the pre-NILDEP scenario, when he has to pay X amount of money from his pocket because of depreciation, at times he was avoiding some of those claims and continue to run cars with small scratches or dents. The moment he realized that everything can be paid by insurance company, those claims went up. So I think, we have to look at both the aspects in terms of how will it drive the frequency or the intent of the consumer to claim And that's why the product is slightly higher priced right now for the customer to uptake to happen. But technically, that product is available in the market. I'm sure most of the insurers have that product available. It is launched also in some of the programs, but somewhere the uptake is pretty low because of the pricing factor. And customer, you don't, so that's the Indian mentality, right? We don't believe that we will hit our car. We don't believe that we will become sick. We always believe that saath wale ke ghar pe aag lagega, saath wala bimar hoga. We never believe in that. And that's why the penetration of insurance is pretty low in India. Since we are optimistic as a country in that sense, at times we don't look at those covers which can help us in long run. So that, but those products are available. We can work together in terms of promoting some of those products. But product is available, at least from our side, that product is available. I'm sure for other clients also, NCP product as a product is approved by the regulator for most of us.
Thank you so much, Nitin. So we're drawing towards the end of the program. So here we would like to take question and answer answers from our question and answer box. Mr. Hitendra has actually suggested that the hydrostatic loss issues should be part of the basic insurance, and it really, it being a blind spot, it leads to severe loss for the insured. So your views on it, gentlemen?
Just to give you an example, I think there's a lot of discussion in the industry on that side, and there's a larger concern. What Hitendra Singh is absolutely right, and there's a lot of consensus in the industry also that the engine protect should become a part of the base cover. But as I said, motor is a tariff product and governed by the regulator. There was a committee which was formed and which is working on looking at the completely new D-tariff product, in which one of the basic recommendation has been making engine product a part of the base cover. So what you're saying is absolutely right. You might see that when the new product comes in, but that is the direction which industry also believes, and which is right way to go.
Aditya, there's another question which actually talks about, it talks about why the known claim bonus, we already covered this one. It talks about the balance insurance revenues and insurance margins and how to guard both. It's a question from Mr. Samir Chaudhary, and he's just asking how we as dealers have to balance these two.
Insurance balances, and so it's a pure business decision actually. So as I said, so probably it's, if I am an insurer, we are manufacturing a product. I earlier mentioned that at least this much we should have a margin. And it depends on the objectives of that business and the shareholder as you, who's going to, what is your appetite? You are going to go for, market share or some other things. And what you, the balance, ultimately, the creation of balance in any scenario is an individual and the, as an individual or the business's decision. So probably I may not be able to comment too much on that. But if there is a situation, we can obviously guide that, okay, this is how it is. And this is how the market is operating. And this is what the economy of scale can play a role, because that also will have a role. You can't be a niche player in these kind of market and try to go only for quality or the high price or something. And you are not trying to balance. So that is something very, very individual also. It depends business to business. It depends two-wheeler, four-wheeler, SUV in a different way. But if I have understood the question right, so we can, have some more details, we probably can, will be able to comment on.
Just to add to Aditya Singh also, Vinesh, at the end of the day, if there is a, in any product of yours, I think you would have seen that, all of you who are businessmen would have seen that, in any product, if you have more margin than and keeping out of the customer pocket, at some point in time it will start draining away because somebody else will take that margin. Because it will never happen that you continue to make money at a higher margin with a consumer. Somebody will see that green spot and will take away that margin. And then what we look at is, how do we drive more value from that customer instead of looking only insurance as one part of it. So look at how do we kind of add more products to our bouquet. In terms of managing profitability, can we look at engaging with the customer on his other insurance needs at some point in time? That could be one value addition which you can bring in. Making more add-ons penetration higher, I think that could also help you to bring your margin. But the expectation that the margin on a basic product remains same, I think will not happen because somebody else will come and squeeze it because there is a margin available and will come and squeeze it. And we have seen that across. I'm sure you would have seen that in your servicing. You would have seen that in your spare. Some point in time, that margin will get squeezed. So how do you bring in efficiency in terms of managing that? Now do you kind of upsell or get higher premium instead of getting a higher margin and keeping your income constant? Is that the direction we should work upon? And looking at customer lifetime value. At times, we believe that a lot of discussion happening on the discounts. My thought is that instead of losing that customer to a digital aggregator, it's better to keep it with the dealer because in the long run, it will give you other revenue resources, which could be your service, claims, and maybe replacement of car. But the retention of a customer is far more critical than making money only on insurance. We should start looking at lifetime value of that customer and how can we drive that. I think will help you to maintain your margin and profitability.
And here, Vignesh, just to add what Nitin said, see, value chain of a customer is the most important piece because if a customer keeps a car for 4 years, next time he's going to buy a new car or say, unfortunately, there's a total loss, he's going to get the salvage value and use it to buy a new car. So what is important is to improve the average ticket size of a customer when he buys a car and give him a complete coverage in terms of toppings. So that you understand that wo ekdam mind free in terms of that is where you increase the ticket size of the premium. When it comes to claims, if you run a lot of mitigation process of reducing that claims, right, it helps both the side. Because end of the day, you are in the business, right? Raman, so the value chain is very critical, which Nitin spoke about, because this is what is product density is all about.
Gentlemen, here we really request you to actually help us skill our manpower, upskill our manpower, because here we're talking a lot about being a consultant. To make sure that we put ourselves in the boots of our customers and start thinking on he or she wants it. Here we really need to happen in dealers and for such a consultancy kind of an approach. And we really seek your support in making sure this happens. We need a lot of handholding here. There's also a question which actually comes from the fact that do you have any data regarding customer satisfaction for a customer who buys insurance from a traditional dealership channel versus the online channels? Is there any study which has been done there or can anything be done?
Can I take? So yeah, Vignesh, all the progressive companies actually, especially in the last one, I'm sure about Bajaj Allianz General Insurance Company and our counterparts who are present in the panel also. We do, NPS we call it, and we do it channel wise, geography wise, and at different levels we do it. And all the data, even we are so equipped now, we can provide you the intermediary wise, that means the dealer wise also, what is the NPS of the customer who have bought insurance and what was their customer lifecycle journey and what are the insights that we have received. So we do discuss this with when we visit and we meet with our dealer partners. We normally discuss these things, but we can make it a formal attempt also where we engage them also and we look at the questions. We as of now, what are the questions that in NPS we broadly frame are from insurer point of view. We can also have similar. We can engage them and we can have their point of view and we engage or frame our questions slightly differently, which will suit their requirement and the kind of insight they are looking at. That can easily be shared when we are working in partnership. I think a lot of such collaboration will bring value to the not only through the relationship, but to the overall business also. So that is available.
Excellent. And there's another question from Mr. Pranav Shah. He says that we have 3 to 5 year TP mandatory for two-wheelers and cars. When can we expect something long-term policy for OD products too?
I think that was already there. Why this got discontinued is what probably would not want to know.
Yeah.
So, the regulator has not allowed that. Regulator has not allowed. Arita, you take it.
No. It's all right, I think.
So yeah. Regulator is not allowing that long-term policies on the standalone OD side. I think as some of the concerns raised by the other insurance partner, which is the agents, etc., that it will further lead to a dominance of the dealer fraternity in that side because long term will be lying there. So that is why it has been withdrawn. But as of now, we don't see any intent of regulator to move in the reverse direction of offering a long term OD policy because the directive from the Supreme Court also was only on the third party. And that is where they're restricting themselves to offering 1+0, 1+5. and subsequently it will be one is to one policy to be renewed or the standalone OD, or 1+1 OD plus TP with policy will get renewed. If something changes, I think, though the industry has been very vociferous that if you have to stop, reduce the uninsured vehicle population, this is the step in the right direction. And I think point which Raman also raised in terms of the amount of claims which come from uninsured vehicles today is very, very high. So clearly, we as industry have been pushing in that side, but I think it will be difficult to comment right now when will that happen. It will be an approval from the regulator in that side before we launch that.
And another question also comes regarding cross-selling, because we have so much of database sitting there with us and a lot of customers who trust our services regarding motor insurance. How much is there a space for also cross-selling other form of insurance, could be general, could be health, towards customers?
May I, Aditya?
Yeah, sure.
Anyway, it's a good opportunity, Vinesh. The only thing, what starting point is the contactability, I will say it again. And if you have 100% contactability and customers have given you good feedback as a starting point in terms of NPS, which Aditya spoke about, it is all because the company has shown at the time of claim that about the good service. And it is right to pitch them. And it is about a complete coverage. What you need to tell is customer, other than motor, you also have health, home insurance. And health is the most critical as of now, looking at first and second wave. There's a big opportunity, but how do you marry this entire piece in along with the contactability to pitch the right product at the right place is the most critical piece.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. I think it's been a great time. It's a great 1.5 hours spent with you. And also thank you so much, Shavik, for joining us and giving us a dealership perspective. Special thanks, of course, is to Aditya, Raman, and to Nikhil for joining us, taking your time off. And it's also an opportunity where a lot of dealers get to see who's the man on top of our partners, because some of us probably the last year and a half or 2 years, we haven't had a physical interaction at all. So it's a great opportunity to meet old friends and also the new acquaintances. Thank you so much again for our dealer members for keeping it quite interesting, and it's been a pleasure for me to moderate this. Can I pass it on to Sahash? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Wow, it has been really an insightful session which we have witnessed in last 1.5 hours. I think just to summarize everything, we have covered a lot of points, which dealers were curious to know about. May it be how is the future evolving for all the dealers and also for the insurance partners in terms of motor insurance products? How do one compete with digital insurance providers and aggregators? One of the most important topics in every dealer's mind today is the evolvement of electric vehicles and what is the future of insurance business specifically for in the auto industry. Also, we have covered how to avoid disputes in non-cashless cases during final settlement and getting interim payments, promotion of motor insurance renewals at dealerships for vehicles which are running uninsured, umbrella policy for auto dealers, and also the most talked about topic, artificial intelligence, and how it will play an important role for all of us in future. I would also like to take this opportunity and thank all our panelists, Mr. Aditya Sharma from Bajaj Allianz, Mr. Nitin Khanna from ICICI Lombard, Mr. Raman Arora from Reliance General Insurance, our state chairman from Rajasthan, Mr. Sharvik Shah, for keeping the dealer's perspective, and not to forget our moderator, Mr. C.S. Vigneshwar, who in a very correct manner acted as a bridge between the dealers and the insurance partners. We are thankful to all of you for taking out time and going so deep in today's discussion, which I'm sure will help all dealer partners who have attended this live webinar session. With this, we will now bring this session to its rightful end. Thank you once again for joining us. We will be back again soon with another topic of